discharge support system or program for patients experiencing psychogenic non-epileptic seizures. She's been married for 25 years and has 3 kids, and we are super happy for her to be here today to talk to you a little bit about how to live better with epilepsy. So without further ado, I'll let her take it over.
Hey, everybody. So no pressure being the first person up, the first in person. And those of y'all that sat in the back, you are my people. I love you. Like she said, I'm like my favorite, and I started in 1997 as a midnight 8 a.m. monitor tech and seizure monitoring in University of Louisville Hospital. Moved on through the neurodiagnostics area, doing all kinds of testing, got a call to become a nurse, and was placed in the neurotrauma ICU. So there I did have experience with post-surgical epilepsy patients, as well as an array of other things, stroke, trauma, those kinds of things. I had the opportunity to go home, which was my epilepsy monitoring unit, and went back as a nurse and became a manager. Got to do some really cool things there with my team. They were amazing. And ultimately left to finish my doctorate. Came back, joined the group about 7 years ago as a nurse specialist. I did the epilepsy surgery coordination for our group, and then have in the last year become the APRN for epilepsy. So, for a long time, I've worked with patients who have epilepsy and seizures. In the interest of full disclosure, I do not have seizures. I don't know what that experience is like. But I do have a nephew who has epilepsy related to gray matter heterotopia, which is an abnormality in his brain from when he was born, and he is happily controlled on one medication. I have a cousin who has medically intractable epilepsy and has been on, I kid you not, every single epilepsy medication, and traveled the journey of what that's like, making those med changes, having reactions, the joy of being seizure-free, and the moment that another seizure happened. She has been through 4 epilepsy surgeries and is seizure-free for a year and a half at this point. So again, I don't know your experience, but I have been so fortunate to be on the journey both professionally and personally with some really heroic people. So I love that I get to talk to you guys a little bit today. I don't pretend to know better how to live with epilepsy, because I don't, but I can tell you about my experiences with patients and with my family, and just give you some things to think about. And hopefully take something today that improves your day a little bit. Okay. The outline is easy. We're going to name it, we're going to claim it, we're going to plan it, we're going to live it. We were supposed to actually do this back in the fall, and didn't end up getting to, so that gave me time. I work with some amazing epileptologists, and I think between all of us, we have like 175 years of experience working all over the world with patients with epilepsy and seizures, and thought that our delay was a wonderful opportunity for me to actually talk to them about what's different. For the folks that we see and we get to participate in their care with, the folks who feel like they're living well and they're doing well and they're making the most of life, what's different for those folks? Where are we doing it right in some spots and failing folks in others, and what conversations should we be having to try to help folks as they're on their own journey? So, we actually kind of came to the conclusion together that it's from the moment of diagnosis that we have the opportunity to help folks live well with epilepsy through a lot of different things that we can do, through helping folks understand epilepsy, through helping folks accept where they're at with epilepsy, and not so much telling folks what to do and we're smart and here's how it's supposed to be, but helping you find your journey. So we're just going to talk a little bit today, and I talk a lot, so I'll try to So you all probably are very well aware that a seizure is a transient occurrence, signs or symptoms due to abnormal excessive synchronous neuronal activity in the brain. Well, that's a mouthful. When I have somebody come in, our doctors have somebody come in, and we're trying to explain you had a seizure. It's a mouthful, and it's a lot, and it's intimidating. We kind of get it, right? Something's going wrong in the brain. That's a lot. That's a lot from the start. The International League of Epilepsy tells us that the mentioned epilepsy is two unprovoked seizures greater than 24 hours apart. For one seizure in which we have some evidence that we're likely to have another seizure in probably the next 2 years. And diagnosis of an epilepsy syndrome. There are some syndromes that we're diagnosed with early on in our life. That we can say, you know, seizures were part of this and we need to be aware. So, those are a lot of words, and they're important words, and words we should understand. But when I have someone who comes in after a first seizure, and I'm going to give you the most high level, like simple, wow, she goes over this definition of a seizure, but I can promise it helps me and it helps my patient look at what we're going to do and what we're facing. So, we're all sitting here today. We're breathing air, our posture's good, we're thinking, wow, where did she come from in Kentucky that her voice sounds like that? What's for lunch? This is interesting, this is not interesting, I'm glad I got here, I wish I'd stayed in bed. All those things are happening. We're maybe sitting there thinking, I should have gone to the bathroom right before I got here, but we can tell our bladder not to release and we're okay. So while all that's going on, the cells in our brain, millions and millions, are in chaos. See, all the time in human existence, we want chaos, and that's when the cells in our brains are all doing their unique jobs to keep all those things I just mentioned happening. Chaos. Provokes about seizures. There's an area, and when I say area, I don't necessarily mean something we can see on a scan. There's an area in the brain that's sometimes irritable all the time, sometimes it's irritable really randomly, but it's irritable. And pokes its head out at some point, so to speak, and looks at the cells around it who are all doing their jobs. It says, hey, join me. I want to do something different, basically. So in that moment of chaos, synchrony happens. And all the cells in that area, and maybe all the cells in the brain, join together, and it's boom, 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 boom. So no chaos. All doing the same thing. So in that moment, whatever area of the brain that is chaotic, is not chaotic, is synchronous, it's also being able to do its job. So for some folks that I hear, maybe noise because that area is in our auditory area. For some folks, it's like a taste. For some folks, it's I'm aware, but arm starts doing something on. For some folks, it moves through the entire brain, and all of a sudden, every cell engages, which means all of our body engages, and that's where we see the seizures that we see sometimes on TV, where there's lots of shaking, arms are really stiff, we lose control of our bladder, because that area can't say, don't do that. We bite our tongue. The air comes out of our lungs. Any number of things. So, fortunately, our brain gets itself back online, chaos comes back over, and then we and our family and our healthcare providers are left to deal with whatever happens when everything, which is being tired, being sore, being scared, being unsure, being disappointed. You know, I know my family member made it a certain number of weeks. Have y'all ever counted the weeks or the days? She made it a certain number of days, and things like driving, I'm having to play, I'm going back to work. Why today you're sleep deprived, you have one, and yesterday you were more sleep deprived than you did. years old. You know, if you have, you break your arm, you have appendicitis, you fix it. But your brain's still doing its thing. It's still chaos up here, mom, you know? And so we really have to give credence to the fact that these seizures are not only really big events that interrupt your life and interrupt your health, they interrupt the nature of who we are sometimes. And so we have to give it its due and make sure we're taking care of all the parts of us afterward. So what do we do? You guys know this already. You have your first seizure. You come to a medical professional, and what do? We look at the form of your brain, and we look at the function of your brain. So we look to see, is there something in your brain that we could, Dr. Tamara is going to talk later, manipulate or take out or do something and make the seizures go away or get better. Yeah. We look at the function, and that's your EEG. So everybody gets an EEG. Usually everybody gets a lot of EEGs over time. We look at the function, and what we look for is chaos. But then we look for that little irritable, it's literally a spike, so it jumps up. There we go. Jumps up and tells us, I'm here. This is the part of your brain that's irritable, or a seizure. So those are the things we look for so that we can help you understand. And the things that we do, and this is not in order of importance, the things that I've just thrown out here, but things we'll recommend. We'll recommend medications. And what do those do? They look for that irritable propensity. They look for the irritability, and they try to keep it from being too irritable. So we're either giving you a medication to prevent it from being too irritable, or calm it down if it seems to. Surgery is an option for some folks, and Dr. Smart is going to do a great talk about surgical options. We'll talk about, and we will talk today about lifestyle recommendations, and sometimes there's diet recommendations. So this is absolutely just an amalgam of different things. There's some more thing you do with epilepsy, number 1, 2, 3, and 4, I believe, is find a provider that you trust, that you can talk to, that you can be honest with, that you can feel like they're in your corner and they're going to keep trying. Epilepsy changes over time, y'all find out that they're not in. You got to have somebody that you can go, you know what? I'm going to take that medicine because I was scared of it. Take that medicine because I'm scared of taking medicine. I take that medicine because 3 times a day when I'm 24 years old is too not much. Not, okay, I'll try. Or they should tell me, like, why it's not okay. Just, I medication, safety, seizure triggers, sleep, diet, health, and dissessing limits. Because I said we're going to talk about an honest playing field. So we're going to talk about all the stuff. So, first thing you can do, and honestly, I think this goes for people who don't have epilepsy, but especially if you have epilepsy, have an expert on yourself. What do I mean? Tell your story to yourself, someone you trust. Talk about the journey to diagnosis. Talk about your feelings. Talk about those pieces and parts. Not for just the sake of talking about it, but so you can go back and look at a narrative. All the stories you've done, thought through, and the people who were helpful to you and the people who were not so helpful to you, so that you can look at your story and you can appreciate your story. But also, then you can understand your seizure triggers. I can tell you all day, if it's sleep, don't have caffeine, please don't drink alcohol, whatever, edible. That's what I do. Just understand your triggers. Write those things down if you can, use your phone, just make a voice memo, whatever. If you're parenting a child with epilepsy and you are working toward that incredible dance of you're an adult now, here, you know, gotta go to doctor's appointments and not answer for them. I gotta let them figure out. You gotta call pharmacy three times sometimes before the visit. Gotta do all those things. Document that experience too. And in a moment where things aren't crazy, sit down and say, okay, this was what we figured out so far, and this is what you can take it or leave it. This is what I'd suggest. Become an expert on the medications that work for you. Write down somewhere the medications that absolutely did not. Write down somewhere why. It's hard because it's a lot going on sometimes. It makes a big difference if you can go to your provider and say, well, this medication didn't work because of X versus, hey, I don't know, I was told, you know, I tried it and it didn't work. Become the expert on when you need to step back and take a break. Some moments to yourself. Become an expert on when you need to find the person that is your support system and say, hey, can you just have lunch with me and let's talk about the frustration that I have. Or let's have lunch and I want to tell you about this one thing I did that I didn't think I was ever going to do. And this is how I did it. And, you know, this is that narrative. It's an amazing narrative for everyone. So become an expert on you. Be a savvy patient. Know your meds. Do the best that you can to know your meds and be able to, you know, have conversations about, yeah, I took Lamictal, but I did have a rash. So, I took this one, and I took Keppra, and I was pretty weird. Nobody wants any part of that, right? Yeah. Or, you know what? I just feel like I got maybe heal, but it didn't stop my seizures. So maybe in the trial that happened. And I'm just saying, on you and you're savvy is patient. Know when you go in to see your provider, whoever it is, now everybody needs a different type of provider. Certain folks like to come in with me and I kind of, you know, get a little bossy, but then I say, hey, I know I'm bossy, but let's see what you need to do. Some people do like the provider because it's a story. Okay. So know what works for you, what makes you comfortable, who you're going to have the most confidence in. Be honest with your provider. For 27 years almost now, definitely had experienced times where the patient comes in and they want to do the right thing. They want to please the doctor. The right thing is, by the way, the right thing is right for you. We want to please the doctor. So they say, yes, sir. Yes, ma'am. Good to go. And then thinking in the back of your mind, fuck that. So 3 months later, 6 months later, 12 months later, they come back and we lost that time where maybe if you had a conversation here, we would have realized, yeah, that's just not what we want. So be honest. Partner with your provider. Let them know. You know, this is making me uncomfortable. This is the best thing. You know, we just need to know all. Today, or I mean, I got to give you this thing, or if you think about it, got to get those meds through the pharmacy, which is long, and obviously our rescue meds, Dr. Gomez, are all scheduled. So when you call your pharmacy, it's really handy to put in the number on your pill bottle. They say, you know, just enter the number and refill your meds. Well, if we sent in a new prescription, it does not connect to that old number. And so we have a lot of experience where then our patient calls us and says, you know, you didn't send in the medication, and we're like, you know, we did, we have whoever. So make sure you talk to somebody at the pharmacy, make sure you're filling as early as you can. It's also, if the medication's expensive, the pharmacy's not going to order it, just have it sitting there. Just on my table. What is
it?
So, is that fair? I mean, I'm not even going to pretend that you shouldn't have to do all that. But I can tell you for sure, 99.9% of the time, we are at the office trying to get those things in because we know the consequences, right? Seizures are the consequences. We don't want any of those. So, that's my one, like, setting trick today. Don't use that number on your prescription bottle if you're close to the end of your refills, because they'll tell you they don't have it. And then you think we didn't send it, and then they don't look for it. So anyway, that's my one, like, and tell everybody how to call. So be savvy. Definitely do, I didn't put this on here, your due diligence on the internet. Difference sometimes between, you know, going on down the road seizure free And, so make a plan. Because if you make a plan before you have an emergency, then it's less than an emergency. What happens if you're sick and you can't take your meds? Have this conversation with your provider, please. Because some folks are taking medications that stay in your system for a longer period of time, and they will tell you, you know what, if you miss a day, and I'm not telling you this, this is your provider, but some medications you can say, well, if you miss a day, I think we're okay, I love it, I think we're okay. Some folks are on medication and you don't miss it by an hour or a procedure. So make a plan with your provider and plan for emergencies. Because emergencies are going to happen, you're out there living life, right? So have that conversation with your provider. And I think it's really worth saying to your nurse practitioner or physician, hey, I just ran an appointment where we sit down between times and we just talk about the stuff that worries me. What am I going to do? Because I'm committed to accepting this diagnosis, to understanding this diagnosis, to living the very, very most amazing life that I'm intended to live. But I got some questions. And sometimes in those quick appointments, people are just saying, hey, Jamie, you're awesome. You saw the next thing. Or it's a little more than that, but sometimes it feels like that. So I suggest over time, especially if life's changing, maybe you're having a baby, of course, you're going to start traveling a bunch because your babies are all grown. Have a conversation with your provider about what kinds of things can I do and plan so that I don't miss medications or what if this happens or what if that happens.
This came from the epilepsy website. Again, I'm not going to go over each case in part, because you probably know I will stress I'm going to stay with the person. Watch. You want to make sure they're safe, turn them to their side, restrain them, because people will wake up and feel like they're being attacked. Nothing can be a provider and not say nothing in anybody's mouth, for sure. I had something yesterday, but that still is happening. And that's just what they learned. So we just talked about how that's not, you know, I didn't say, oh my gosh. Make a plan for you. There's all kinds of, I have in my office, there's a one-page form that I'll just sit down with a patient and say, okay, this is your person, and we kind of click off and write online. Sometimes they give that to their school or their work, sometimes they just keep it in their house. Make a plan for you about what typically will happen. I am not giving any specific instruction, but make a plan for when the ER is necessary. Not necessary when it's not necessary. That is individual. No, I'm telling anybody not to go to ER. But there are some patients who feel it's inappropriate. And so make that plan before you have an emergency so that everybody is aware of what you do, heaven forbid you, and let yourself know. So it's really hard sometimes to decide who's my circle that I can trust, who are the folks that are going to do the things that I need them to do for me in the moment when I'm not able to take care of myself. You get to choose your circle, your neighbor, if they're not trustworthy, or they're going to gossip, or they're going to whatever. They don't have to be in your circle. You have no plan. Choose your circle, trust your circle, and set boundaries. So, and then debrief after an event. I think that's really important, and don't necessarily do that. Sometimes it feels like seizures are the cost of day-to-day living, and we're used to it, and you know, it's you just keep going, you keep on keeping on, everything's okay, we're fine. Give yourself time to debrief if a seizure happens. You know, maybe if you're the parent or the caregiver, you debrief with someone other than the patient or your loved one. Give yourself time to debrief, feel what you feel. Triggers, I think everybody here has probably heard about triggers. Stress and anxiety can be huge, and that is such a funny thing to talk about, because women are stressed and anxious these days. And I'm only kind of kidding. The last 2 to 3 years, we have dealt with stress and anxiety at a level in our society that probably never seen before. I actually, as an aside, work with patients who have non-epileptic seizures, and some of my non-epileptic seizure patients, and I'm not saying everybody, but a few, actually did okay.
now your life is like mine. I can deal with this anxiety of, you know, not being able to do what I do with this other day. And so it's just, it's interesting how you process. Lack of sleep is a definite, definite, definite issue for folks who have epilepsy. Sleep is, of course, managed in the brain. And anything that gets things off in the brain, it's really how the way of looking at it, gives the potential for whatever little irritable spot you have to go, well, I've had it today. Where we aim in life for as much balance as possible. It's not perfection. Don't get stressed out about perfection, but try not to miss meals. Try to get as good as you can. If you notice caffeine, you're the expert on you. If you notice caffeine is a thing for you, try to not do that. My best friend ever was, and I'll give you this piece of advice that you absolutely don't need. Don't buy medications at the checkout at the gas station and take them. Those are situations, so we don't do that. Flashing lights, here's some folks, that's an issue for some folks not. Being in front of yourself and no skipping medications absolutely happens. I forgot the cholesterol medication last night. I will not have the potential to have a big event today because of that, so I totally get it. We work really hard not to skip medication if we can. Illness and fever. Alcohol and recreational drug use. Sometimes when the things we are working to help folks with are failing them, people will self-medicate with alcohol and other things, and that's understandable. Sometimes if we're not recognizing that anxiety and depression are a part of having a chronic issue, and we're not working on that with you, then self-medicating would happen. And so it's understandable. We just got to sit down with does happen, you know, we figure it out. Those are definitely seizure triggers. They alter brain chemistry. Sleep we talked about. Seizures are very sensitive to sleep patterns. Some people have their first seizures after an all-nighter in college. Some people will tell me every seizure I've had is at 6:15, 6:22, 6 whatever in the morning. Have epilepsy, lack of good sleep, so not just laying in the bed, but good sleep. We see a lot of folks for sleep studies. If you have any doubt about apnea, holy cow, get a sleep study because that can be a game changer for seizures. Absolutely, it doesn't matter how old you are. My husband's skinny as a rake, and he had apnea really early on just by how his throat was formed. He doesn't have epilepsy, I tell you. And then, just as a rule, and I just mentioned it, during normal sleep-wake cycles, changes in your brain's electrical and hormonal activity occur, so when you get that on balance, it's your danger. Balance is key. Keto, of course, is utilized in pediatric populations. You know, what we hear is keto can be really good in pediatric populations because parents and caregivers have more control. A lot of times, feeding situations, you can really get tight control. It's harder in adults. Harder to tell yourself that's a no for me forever. Even occasionally, if somebody says, I mean, I had a patient recently who said, you know, I used to do keto just because I wanted to lose weight and I found my seizures were better control. Okay. Do it safely. No extremes, but you know, there's no reason if it's something that works for you, then you know. Supplements, you have to be super duper careful with supplements just because it came from nature doesn't mean it's good for us. So you really have to watch supplements. We're all about the supplements, I think, these days. I have two or three that I take as it is, and sometimes your provider will suggest you take some supplements. But definitely find out what's in those supplements. I had somebody who that brought me the container with the public, and there just had words on it, like just the name of it. They said, well, I don't know what's in it, but this person on next week said, and you know what? Hey, if you have uncontrolled problems and you're desperate, I totally get it, but I thought, my gosh, I'm going to have a conversation because, right? So just be careful. Just be really careful. Know what you're putting in your body. I know that CBD, we don't have enough time today to probably cover that one. Just be careful if you're eating on a supplement that you know that it's from a reputable person, group,
company, and
then you talk to your provider.
Emotional health, I think most of my talk today has talked about emotional health, and I can't overstate it. Epilepsy is an organic issue. It is abnormal firing in your brain. You can start it, you can't stop it on your own. You can build it on. I'm saying that. So when I'm talking about emotional health, I'm talking about the things that that organic disease, the thing that comes from the body, can do to your mental health. It is a fact that folks with epilepsy have a higher likelihood to have depression. We talked about epilepsy is a disorder that attacks the seat of the soul, so to speak. So it's our brain, it's the part of us that processes emotions. So talk to your providers about depression and anxiety. It certainly can trigger seizures. Guys, we want you to have the best life. And so if there's something we can do to help with depression and anxiety, we should be doing that. And we're failing, which we're not, by the way. I'm certainly not citing ignorant, but I'm failing my patients because I used to say with surgery, when I was the coordinator of surgery, we would give people the jump inside. We would give people what I consider to be a surgical intervention that cured epilepsy. We had patients we asked, we would cure epilepsy. We got to lower meds. We got to not really ever go off and get things much back to normal. There's one of having dogs and the first time because their seizures are controlled and all these pieces and parts of them. We had a decent group of folks. Depressed and anxious and debilitated. And look what we did. We had the highest intervention you can do. I mean, it is brain surgery, right? We failed our patients because we like them to say, we had a plan after surgery. We got to know that sometimes surgical interventions can bring on some depression and anxiety. So why don't most of the time? We've got to send this person to vocational rehab. So suddenly their family, and I think one particular is like, oh, they're a child, you know, you can get a job, you can watch the kids, you can drive, you can do all these things, and we have to bring that person for a completely different life. So when you end up the keys to the kingdom, and we didn't show them who the door was. You know? So I talk a lot about that. But folks who are on a daily basis, dealing with having seizures, having the risk of seizures, taking medications for seizures, doing the work over and over and over, setting their playing field, knowing this is what I've got to do to be the healthiest they can be, I do not want to fail by not addressing the emotional parts. And so that means talk to me about why, or I have talk to me about why, even though you're telling me you don't have side effects on this medicine, talk to me. I look at every patient encounter, really every place I go to, what is my role today? And so I can't overstate enough. Take care of all of you. You're working so hard to do the right things and putting up the side effects and millions of things that I don't know and I'm not experienced and I have no right to tell you how you should feel. But I do know that you are worthy of doing the best that you can. So partner with your providers. Debrief, take care of your emotional health, and we're also being here. When we talk about limits, now I'd be a fool if I stood here and told you. Because there are. We probably shouldn't be flying airplanes. We have seizures that are in control. We're going to tell you that if you have seizures that are in control, we want you to be safe, not to limit, but to say, yeah, that was from the lake, actually. And we're going to say, no driving for a while, at least 90 days in Kentucky. We're going to say, we're going to have to limit your job. The stress of this job causes issues. But that is where we need providers to Shaver saw a patient recently, and we thought, we didn't think things were going to go. So a year later, he walked across the country. Aha, he didn't think he would walk across if we had no therapy. But, you know, so he stayed on the journey. He said it's what he did. He got to the seizure control, and he found the things that would help him to live his best life. So, live it. And the answer on you. Learn all that you can and don't drown in the internet. But learn all that you can, just about you, about your providers, about what they can offer. I personally have been a nurse for a million years. I wanted my patients to have a provider that they're comfortable with, so I work at UML, Cornell, and place little groups and walls. But I want every patient to get to the provider that can give them what they need. Partner. Find what you love and find ways to do it. Once you set that playing field, once you get towards seizure control, once it doesn't feel like everything's out of control, find ways. And then finally, I would just say, be unapologetically and unequivocally. Because the journey with epilepsy can be really tough one, and it definitely molds people into the people they are. And then there's some of the most interesting, brave, funny, just amazing people I know, and while I wouldn't wish anything on anyone except for perfect health, they wouldn't be as good as they are. So, and reach out to the Epilepsy Foundation. That's why we're here today, is to know that we're all loved, and it's a very, very good, it's an awful lot of pleasure. So, does anybody have any questions or any comments?
Yeah.